Let's take the potential flow around a circular cylinder one step further and add a line vortex. So remember that before we took uniform flow, we added it to doublet flow, and we got flow over a circular cylinder. And now we're going to add a line vortex or a two-dimensional vortex right at the center of that cylinder. And this is these are the potential flow equations for that line vortex. We're simply going to add that to what we had previously. Now, we can look at the radius of the cylinder, and actually the radius of the cylinder doesn't change from what we had previously. Now remember that we previously computed that the radius of the cylinder when we added the uniform to the doublet flow was related to the strength of the doublet flow and the strength of the free stream velocity. Well, it turns out that the line vortex doesn't produce any velocity in the R direction, and or in the radial direction. And because of that, the streamline that produces the surface of this cylinder actually does not change its radius with the addition of a vortex here, the two-dimensional vortex, because there's no radial contribution. We found the strength or this radius here by equating this term with this term in the previous example. And but since this does not contribute to that radial component, the radius does not change. So we can leave that the same. And let's just draw out what this the three components we're adding together. We've got a free stream velocity of strength V infinity. We're going to add that to a doublet, which looks like this. And then we're also going to add a vortex, which looks like this. Okay, and now let's see, the doublet has strength kappa, and the vortex has a strength of gamma. Okay, so if we take these three now and add them together and swap out the kappa value for the radius of the cylinder, we get first the potential, the velocity potential is equal to V infinity times R plus capital R squared over R times the cosine of theta minus gamma over 2 pi times theta. And then the velocity, which is the gradient of the velocity potential, is equal to V infinity, 1 minus capital R squared over little r squared, times the cosine of theta, and that's in the r hat direction, minus V infinity, 1 plus capital R squared over little r squared, times sine of theta, plus gamma over 2 pi r, and that's in the theta hat direction, and then of course zero in the z hat direction. Okay, so this is our velocity potential and our velocity vector at any point in the flow, at any r theta location. And we can get that in the r hat direction, the theta hat direction, and nothing in the z hat direction. Okay, so let's add these together and see what that flow would look like. We get, let's see, we've got some free stream velocity coming in here, and we've got a point now that has both a doublet and a vortex at that point, and it's going to create the streamline is going to create a cylinder around that based off of the doublet. And but because of the vortex, the flow is going to look a little different than it did before. We're going to have some flow that, this is going to move our stagnation point down from the center line. Before, so here's our center line here of that cylinder. Before, without any vorticity and just a free stream velocity in a cylinder, then our stagnation point would have been right here along that center line. But with this circulation now, the stagnation point moves down, and we could look at a streamline going to and from that stagnation point. So our flow is going to look something like that with positive circulation. That's if gamma is positive. Then it will move those streamlines below the center line. If gamma was negative, then the stagnation points would move above that center line. So I've got an image of two different examples here. The one on the left is for gamma equals zero. So if we don't have any circulation, then that's what the flow of that cylinder would look like. And the one on the right is with gamma greater than zero, so with some circulation. So there are actually three different cases that we need to talk about here, three different categories of the strength of gamma. So the first is if gamma is less than 4 pi V infinity times R, and that's the case that we've drawn here, where we'll have streamlines move along the lower part of the surface and then exit, the stagnation point will move down a little bit. Now if gamma is equal to 4 pi V infinity R, then that gamma now is strong enough to move that streamline all the way to the bottom, the stagnation point, all the way to the bottom. So we would have a flow that looks something like this. So those two stagnation points will coalesce if gamma is strong enough, if there's enough circulation. And then finally, if gamma is even greater than 4 pi V infinity R, those stagnation points can actually, after they've coalesced to the bottom there, can actually move off of the cylinder itself. And so the flow around the cylinder will go something like that, and then we'll have the free stream flow coming in something like this. So there will be that stagnation point now has moved completely off. The flow around the cylinder is just unidirectional. It goes all the way around the cylinder, and the stagnation point no longer is on the surface of the geometry. So these are the three different regions of the strength of gamma and what those stagnation points would look like and what the streamlines would look like. Now, something interesting to look at here is the streamlines. So let's just look at these streamlines here on the case for no circulation. And remember that mass cannot cross a streamline. So all of the mass that's entering right here has to pass through all of this region here. Now you see that this area above the cylinder is much smaller than the inlet area down here. And so that means that the velocity is going to be much higher. And according to Bernoulli's equation, the pressure is going to be much lower because those streamlines are closer together. Okay, so we have higher pressure, higher velocity here, lower velocity out here. And so all of these streamlines here are equally spaced. And so you can see there's actually really high pressure in here compared to really low pressure here. And again, high pressure back here. So if we were to look at the pressure on the upper surface of the cylinder, we would see that we start off here with some high pressure, then we go to really low pressure, and then high pressure again. And if we look at the bottom of the cylinder, we actually follow that same pattern. We start off with high pressure, go to a low pressure region here, and then high pressure here again. And so if we were to integrate the pressure around this cylinder, we would find that the lift is equal to zero. There's no net force on this cylinder, and so our lift would be equal to zero. Now let's look at it on the example on the right, where we've added some circulation. So we've got, again, regions of high pressure where there's a large area, between these streamlines, And then regions of really low pressure. In fact, this is even lower pressure than what we had over here. See how close those streamlines are? Oh, we've got a really low pressure on the upper surface of that cylinder. If we were to integrate the pressure now around this cylinder, because of the extremely low pressure here and the relatively high pressure here below the cylinder, we get some positive lift. So in this case, lift is greater than zero. So what we'll find is actually, we've demonstrated this on a cylinder, but it's true of other geometries as well. The circulation is actually directly proportional to the lift that you get on that object. And again, we've demonstrated that just with a cylinder, but we'll find that that's true for other geometries, and we'll be studying airfoils specifically. But that circulation and lift are just directly proportional to each other, and we're going to learn about that proportionality constant here in a couple more lectures called the Kutta-Joukowsky theorem. But that allows us to go between lift and circulation. If we know one, we can calculate the other. We can go back and forth because they are just directly proportional. So let's look at one other thing here. Let's just write out the pressure equation that includes now the vorticity. If we were to write the pressure, and let me just draw this. So we're going to write an equation for the pressure on the surface of this cylinder, okay? And remember that the coefficient of pressure, Cp, from Bernoulli's equation is equal to P minus P infinity over 1/2 rho V infinity squared. And that simplifies to 1 minus V over V infinity quantity squared. So if you know the velocity at any point in the flow, you can calculate the coefficient of pressure. So let's write the coefficient of pressure around the cylinder, just on the surface of the cylinder. That's equal to 1 minus 4 sine squared theta minus 2 gamma over pi r v infinity times the sine of theta minus gamma over 2 pi r v infinity, and that quantity is squared. Okay, so if we have a non-zero gamma, then these terms here will be non-zero. If we don't, if gamma is equal to zero, then we get the pressure over a cylinder without circulation, and that's that equation there. So that pressure is the same on the upper surface or the lower surface. So at any theta value, we can calculate what the pressure is. And on the right, if we use this full equation, we can get the pressure even including the circulation. And it's actually the integral of the pressure that gives us the lift. And we've talked about the fact that we can see very easily from the streamlines that we have lift once gamma is positive. But we could also just integrate that pressure equation to get the same thing.